to you.
Some weaponry has made its way to Kurdistan from the United States and from allies around the world, but we are having a problem in the sense that Baghdad is now asking that all weaponry be redirected through Baghdad, which is a problem for us, Brett.
Yeah, so as far as direct assistance from the U.S. to Kurdish fighters in heavy weapons, for example, that has not happened.
We've not received heavy weaponry yet from the United States. We've made this request.
To be clear about the ISIS threat, is there an imbalance in the weapons they have and the weapons you have?
There is a great imbalance in the weaponry, Brett, because ISIS have state-of-the-art U.S.-supplied weaponry that they were able to take with ease from the Iraqi armed forces. When they took over Mosul, they took over the arsenal of the Iraqi army in Mosul, which includes sophisticated artillery, new mortars, armored personnel carriers, up-armored Humvees, heavy machine guns. And this was all used against us. U.S. Air Forces being used to strike U.S. weaponry, which has unfortunately fallen into the hands of ISIS. We, on the other hand, are dealing with old Soviet weapons from the 60s and 70s and have been used in numerous battles over the last few decades. Our weaponry cannot be compared to the weaponry that ISIS has, but we have the heart, we have the spirit, we have the bravery, and we have the dedication required to win this fight. If that is coupled with upgraded weaponry, with upgraded cooperation with our friends and allies in the United States, we will have no doubt that we can eliminate ISIS from Iraq.
You're saying it has not directly come from the U.S. yet. What specifically can the U.S. do to help the Kurds be the boots on the ground against ISIS?
I think we have to overcome this legal conundrum of whether or not the United States can directly support the Kurdish security forces. This is no time for lawyers to be holding up people's lives here. We need quick, direct, decisive decisions to supply direct heavy weaponry to Kurdish security forces, to the Kurdish Peshmerga, so we can fight this fight with U.S. air cover. Our soldiers can be armed with the weaponry required to drive ISIS out of the country. This will help also the Iraqi security forces from the south to do what they need to do to also squeeze ISIS. Collectively, Iraq, Kurdistan, and the United States can do this, can accomplish this mission and drive ISIS from Iraq. But this requires decisive action, and decisive action now.
In Estonia, President Obama this morning, talking about the fight against ISIS, said at first that the strategy was to destroy ISIS, degrade and destroy. And then he said this:
we can continue to shrink ISIL's sphere of influence, its effectiveness, its financing, its military capabilities, to the point where it is a manageable problem.
So the question, Mr. Minister, is do you agree that you can manage this terrorist army?
I will ask a question back to our colleagues and friends in the United States. Will they accept a foreign entity to exist within Iraq that has no respect for the laws of the country, that acts within as a country within a country? Because if that's acceptable to the United States, in whatever size, small, medium, or large, then why is there such hesitancy towards Kurdistan being its own independent country when we are clearly allied to the United States? We clearly have democratic values that are similar to values in the United States. We certainly will not tolerate this group to exist in any form or fashion, in any size, manageable or unmanageable in the country. The United States should not accept ISIS to maintain a foothold in Iraq. I would go so far as to say that the United States and the rest of the world should not accept ISIS to maintain a foothold in Syria, which was really the birthplace of ISIS. But this requires cooperation. This also requires Iraq to come to this decision that they must not allow for this group to have a base inside Iraq or Syria, and that everyone has to do everything in their power not to shrink the influence of ISIS, but to eliminate the ISIS, to eliminate its threat and its ideology from our country and from the region.
Is Iran currently doing more than the U.S. to help in your fight?
Iran, like the United States, is very concerned by ISIS. They've been actively engaged in assisting Iraq in dealing with this ISIS threat. I'm not going to get into the business of who's doing more and who's doing what. There's a lot of countries interested in this issue. There are a lot of countries that are scared of ISIS and that feel that ISIS is a threat to Iraq. It's a threat to values. It's a threat to democracy. And it's important for all those countries that have the same vision that ISIS must not be allowed to remain in Iraq to work together, even if it creates some uncommon alliances.
You know, Mr. Minister, I've been to Erbil, I've been to Kurdistan, throughout all that region, and when I traveled there, it was a very peaceful place. It was really the safest place in Iraq. For perspective, for viewers at home, give us a sense of what this all means for you and your people.
In the capital of Erbil, in the second city of Sleymaniye, in other key cities around Kurdistan, you feel a sense of relative calm and stability. We know that our brave fighters are fighting this fight on the front lines. They're fighting this fight on the front lines so they don't have to fight them here in the cities inside Kurdistan. But it's also a reminder that we are living in a troubled region, a region that cannot be neglected, a region that cannot be ignored, and a region that we all have to work together to try to bring about a semblance of stability and tolerance and coexistence.
Mr. Minister, we thank you for your time and good luck.
Thank you, Brett.
Up next.